Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks with Dr. Kathryn Smith, a pediatric transplant hepatologist at Johns Hopkins, about mysterious cases of hepatitis that are appearing in young children. They discuss why it's happening now and whether we're seeing a new illness or just something we found more of because we're looking for it. Let's listen. Kathryn Smith, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
So today I wanted to talk about these unexplained hepatitis cases we've seen in young children. Could you lay out the issue for us?
So there was a cluster of kids that were noted to have acute severe hepatitis. And I think in the United States, the first cluster was in Alabama. And so it was put on the radar of the CDC. The original thought that it was related to adenovirus. So that's how everything started.
And so where are we today?
So today the CDC has sort of started an initiative to investigate the causes of these episodes. The data that they have now is retrospective, some of it, all the way back to October. So, you know, we have to interpret numbers in that setting. Right now we know that most states, there are a few states that haven't seen any cases, but most states in the U.S. have had some cases of hepatitis. Most of these are happening in kids under 10. So far, we don't have an exact etiology for why these kids are presenting this way. As I said before, the original thought was that it was maybe related to adenovirus, although it's not firmly established that that's what's causing these episodes.
So adenovirus is just like a cold virus, right?
Yeah, so adenovirus is called the common cold, which can either present with sometimes cough, runny nose, fever, sometimes can present with GI symptoms like diarrhea and stomach ache, generally does not present with acute severe hepatitis. So that was the different and unique finding that was present here.
Mm-hmm. And so hepatitis, I mean, we all have heard of it, but what is hepatitis?
So hepatitis just means inflammation of the liver. Hepa means liver and itis means inflammation. There's lots of different types of hepatitis and lots of different causes. So generally, when people hear hepatitis, they think about infectious hepatitis, like hepatitis A, B, and C. Mm-hmm. But really, there are lots of different viruses and infections that can cause hepatitis. There's lots of different congenital or acquired disorders. So hepatitis is just an umbrella term for any type of inflammation of the liver.
Mm-hmm. And you said that it started and a cluster was first located in Alabama, but now it's a lot of places. So
yes,
why is this happening?
So, you know, one of the questions is whether or not this is something new and unique, or it's just a case of us looking for something, right? We had this cluster that started in Alabama that was interesting because it was several kids in a short time period. And they weren't from exactly the same area, right? They were scattered across Alabama. So then it's put on the map, you know, the CDC is interested. And so as a result, you know, we have a magnifying glass essentially on all cases of hepatitis that are found in kids that are young. What I can tell you as a hepatologist, a pediatric hepatologist, we see acute severe hepatitis frequently. So it's not out of the ordinary to see it. So the question is this something actually new and unique in some sort of cluster, or are we just paying more attention and gathering data that's always been there?
And I guess that makes me think sort of why now, really? Is it just because of sort of this microscope?
Well, you know, one of the questions about perhaps why we're seeing more of it, if we are in fact seeing more, is whether there's some change in sort of how the immune system of children are reacting since we're coming out of an isolation period and setting in a pandemic, right? So the idea has been floated around that perhaps kids have been isolated and you know, everybody's been at home and you don't have the same exposure that kids have as they grow up with schools and interacting with other, you know, people and out in the environment in general, that perhaps we've sort of revved up the immune system now that we're back into normal, somewhat normal life. That's one hypothesis. The other hypothesis of whether or not this may be related to COVID, you know, itself, the COVID virus. Those are questions we don't really know the answer to. So whether or not this is, I guess the ultimate question is whether or not this is actually something new, or whether we're just paying more attention to the episodes and frequency of cases. And then if it is increased number of cases, what is it actually related to and what are the causes?
Why is this only happening with children?
That's a good question. That relates back to the question of whether or not it's something in the immune system. So, you know, in general, as children, the immune system, as it develops over time, you have your exposure to different germs. And we really, when you have kids in isolation, the assumption is that you just don't have the same amount of exposure, right? So that's one question. I guess that's the ultimate question is why are we only seeing it in children? Yeah.
So you said that this causes inflammation of the liver. Are children dying from this? Is there other long-term harm?
So there are a few deaths reported. Of course, again, you know, we don't have a true etiology in those cases of what caused the death. You know, in any type of inflammation of the liver or hepatitis, you always run the risk of that disease progressing into liver failure. That process can look different for different types of diseases and etiologies. In general, it looks like there hasn't been any death since February. So that's good news. And perhaps maybe you were watching for it more carefully and were able to intervene earlier. Perhaps public knowledge and education about it has led to parents bringing in kids sooner. In general, when you talk about hepatitis long-term, it depends on the amount of damage that's done to the liver during the time of acute illness, right? So acute inflammation and it's controlled, then you will not have a lot of long-term effects from it. Of course, if inflammation is ongoing in the liver, eventually that turns into scarring, and that's when you really get the issues down the line.
So if my kid is sick, how would I even know that they had hepatitis?
So usually the signs of hepatitis in children is going to be jaundice. So you see yellowing of the skin and eyes, very dark urine. Sometimes they will have fatigue and not feel well. Occasionally you'll see, you know, nausea, vomiting. But jaundice is probably the most pronounced symptom or sign that you'll see. And that's probably what prompts most of our pediatricians and general pediatricians to obtain labs.
Now, have you seen any of these patients?
So, you know, interestingly, we've had a few cases of acute hepatitis here, but it's been from other causes. So I haven't had anybody yet that fits. I mean, I guess it would depend on how you wanted to say it fits, because I have had severe hepatitis in children. But I haven't had anybody that to me is sort of unknown. I usually can decide what the cause is. So most of them that have diagnosed with either autoimmune hepatitis or some kind of infection.
So this is a different type of hepatitis than I know that kids get hepatitis A and B shots when they're little. And this is a different kind of disease that is going to feel like it comes out of nowhere in some ways.
Yeah, this is different. So hepatitis A and B and C are, you know, the traditional one. When people think about viral hepatitis, that's what they think about. But as you said, most kids are immunized against A and B. And hepatitis C is something that's not as common anymore. Usually you only see it from vertical transmission if you have a mother that's hep C positive. But we can also treat hep C now. We have treatments for it. This hepatitis is different, and it does come out of the blue. So it kind of presents as like a typical viral illness, you know, with runny nose, vomiting, diarrhea, et cetera, and then they develop jaundice. I think the best way to prevent it is just, you know, regular hand washing, making sure your hygiene is good. There's people sick around you that you stay away from those people or be careful.
So, you know, it's a stressful time to be a parent, right? I mean, you're hearing, we've all been worried about COVID for a long time. The youngest kids still can't get vaccinated against it. What do you tell parents?
I think, you know, what I would tell parents is that, you know, there's a few things. I think the first thing I would say is just be vigilant about your child's health. And I think, you know, parents know their kids the best. If you think something is wrong, call your pediatrician, let them know. You know, I think that the pediatricians are aware of this, you know, these different epidemics and things that are popping up. The second thing I would say is try to understand that we're in an age of very quick and information, frequency of updating information. Everything is instant on your phone access. And a lot of times we get a lot of information before we really know what that information means. And this is a perfect example. Keep that in mind when all these things come up. Yeah.
That sounds like some very good advice. Kathryn Smith, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.